if Michael played today,
yeah,
he'd probably average almost 50 a game.
How many points a game would Michael Jordan average if he played in this league, this style, the way they play now?
10 more than his highest year.
47.
MJ would get 50.
Phil Jackson said this when he was promoting his book years ago. If Mike played today, he would average 45 in his prime.
Easy.
You believe that?
Mm-hmm.
If Michael played in this era, he'll average 50. He'll average 50 points. I don't know why you guys discussed the GOAT. Why you discuss the GOAT?
I agree.
Many old heads who witnessed Jordan play always make these claims. They say if Jordan played today, he would tear up today's league, average 50, and so on. But why do they say these things? Is it because they're all fans of Jordan? Or is it because they hate today's young players? Those are ways some people choose to spin it. But if you ask me, it's simply their honest thoughts based on what they saw from Jordan when they played, and based on the ways the game has changed and how offense is more inflated in modern basketball. That is essentially what inspired this video. But let's take a more analytical approach and figure out how much we think Jordan would average if he played in the modern NBA. First off, before we continue, let's establish two things. One, Michael Jordan is the greatest scorer ever, and two, offense is easier nowadays. Establishing Jordan as the greatest scorer shouldn't be a difficult starting point. Jordan has the highest points per game average in NBA history at 30.1, just slightly ahead of Wilt Chamberlain. Jordan also has the highest playoff scoring average of all time at 33.4 points. No one else averages over 30. MJ has the most scoring titles ever at 10, Wilt is second at 7, and no one other than Wilt has half as many as Jordan does. He also did all of his scoring in an era where less points were available, which brings us to the next point. Points are easier to score today. In MJ's final season with the Bulls, he averaged 28.7 points per game as a 35-year-old, and teams around the league were averaging a total of 95.6 points per game. In today's NBA, teams are averaging 111.4 points per game. To put that in perspective, that's the highest average since the days Wilt Chamberlain played decades ago. Teams currently are shooting nearly 10 more shots per game and also 3 times more 3-pointers per game than when MJ retired from the Bulls. In the 1990s, Jordan averaged over 30 points per game 5 times, but in that entire decade, only one other player averaged over 30 points in a season, and that was Karl Malone in the 1990 season. Again, 2 players over that entire decade. In the last 5 years alone of the modern NBA, 5 different players have exceeded 30 points per game. It's a much different time. So now that we've established these facts, we have to ask, why is this happening? Why is there so much more points to go around? Well, there's several reasons. For one, back when Jordan played, you used to be able to hand check players, meaning you could place your hands on the offensive player. You could even put your hands on his hip to essentially steer him to wherever you wanted him to go. As an offensive player, have you ever tried a crossover dribble while the defender's hands are literally on your midsection? It makes dribbling, playmaking, and creating space way more difficult. Second is the defensive 3-second violation. When Jordan played, the defending center could camp under the basket all game long without any penalties or drawbacks. It's one of the major reasons why the physical big man enforcer type has essentially gone extinct, because not only can you play less physically now, but you also can't just camp in the paint all game long anymore. Now, as a center, you have to be constantly moving and sometimes leave the painted area, which means it's free of defense and penetration baskets often go uncontested. We know how valuable rim protection is in the modern NBA, but it's nothing compared to how valuable it was in the 90s when a big man could essentially live there and was always waiting to meet Jordan when he attacked the rim. Third is the most obvious and referred to reason for the inflation of scoring, and it's the surge in 3-point attempts. I've done videos on why there are more 3-pointers shot today, and you can check those out. But simply put, a 3-pointer is 33% more points per basket, and that adds up over the course of a game and over the course of a season. Some have used this as a reason to be skeptical that Jordan would thrive in today's NBA. A lot of people claim that Jordan was a bad 3-point shooter, but that's not completely true. It was at a point, as he definitely started out as a terrible three-point shooter, but Jordan actually grew into a pretty good one as his career progressed. He had a really high three-point percentage in 1996 and 1997, but those 2 years were a short stint where the NBA actually had a shorter three-point line, so let's not include those years. From 1989 to 1993, Jordan actually shot 34.3% from three-point range. To put that in perspective, throughout Kobe's prime, he shot about the same percentage from three-point range. In LeBron's last 5 seasons, he shot nearly the same percentage as Jordan as well. So honestly, Jordan's three-point shooting woes are way overblown. He wouldn't be affected negatively in this modern three-point shooting era. With all of this being said, I think it's fair to say that naturally, Jordan's scoring and dominance would increase in today's game. But to what extent? Something that is often ignored is the rate in which the NBA changed throughout Jordan's playing days. Jordan's highest scoring season was the 86-87 season, where he averaged 37.1 points per game, and the league average per team was 109.9 points per game. 10 years later, Jordan again is leading the league in scoring, but now he's doing it at 29.6 points per game, and the league average is 96.9 points per game. So it's not like Jordan never benefited from more offense, because especially in the late 80s, the tempo was way different. The game had more possessions and revolved around fast break basketball. Things slowed down in the 90s, and instead, physical big men defined that era, which was played with way more half-court sets. If you look at James Harden's numbers from this season in comparison to Jordan's 1987 season, you'll see that although there is an advantage in Harden's era, it's certainly more comparable. Saying Jordan would average 50 in today's NBA is probably a little much, especially when you consider this. When Phil Jackson was asked about the difference between Kobe Bryant and Michael Jordan, one of the things he mentioned was that Kobe was more prone to assert his game and try to take over the game offensively, while Michael Jordan did all of his damage within the flow of the team's offense. As someone who watched both players extensively, I agree with that assessment, and it's one of the reasons that Jordan was able to be so efficient shooting the basketball, even as a perimeter guard. So with that being said, it's hard for me to see a player averaging 50 in any era to be coming from a guy who plays within the flow of the offense. If I had to guess how much Michael Jordan would average in today's NBA, and I'm not talking about 98 Last Dance 35-year-old Jordan, I'm talking about prime scoring Michael Jordan, the one that dropped 40 points in 9 straight games, 63 in the playoffs against the number 1 ranked defense, and the MJ who averaged 42 points in a final series. In my opinion, that version of Jordan would average 40 to 43 points in today's NBA. It would be an efficient 40 points a game within the flow of the offense while being the best defender at his position. For anyone who thinks that's ridiculous, listen to this closing thought. When people say Jordan would average significantly more in today's NBA, it's not because they worship Jordan, it's because people who really know basketball recognize the nuances and greatness of Jordan's game and how that translates to the modern game. Jordan would take advantage of today's more open version of basketball because he had all the skills and was poetry in motion. The vast majority of his moves were smooth and methodical. There wasn't unnecessary dribbling, his handle was tight and calculated. His footwork was pristine and reliable. He had a fantastic hesitation dribble, and he could attack you in so many ways. If he couldn't simply elevate over you, then he would wait and shoot the ball on his descent. That's an unorthodox way of shooting the basketball, and few can hit that shot very often. But nobody did it as well as Jordan did. His fadeaway was extremely efficient and near impossible to block. As he's falling a couple feet back, while elevating as high as he does, how can the defender possibly contest it? Jordan could basically get a quality shot whenever he wanted. If he decided to attack the basket, he had one of the quickest first steps of anyone who's ever played. You could simply hack him to try to stop him from scoring, but with Jordan being an 83.5% free throw shooter, do you really think that's a legitimate solution? Not to mention how Jordan is one of the greatest ever at finishing through the contact. So even if you tried to hit him and make it more difficult in that way, many times it just turned into an and one. You couldn't play tight on him because he was too quick and would often get past you. You couldn't play off of him because he was too lethal from the perimeter. If you pushed him to his right, he had numerous counter moves to punish you. If you pushed him to his left, he also had numerous counter moves to punish you. And on top of all of this, everyone knew you shouldn't piss him off, because believe it or not, somehow that always made him even better. Let me know in the comments section how much you think a prime Michael Jordan would average in the modern NBA. Thanks for watching as always. Make sure to like and subscribe for more NBA content, and I'll see you guys in the next video.